When I first became reasonably well acquainted with the six Brandenburg concerti during my first year of undergrad school, the third of them immediately became and has remained my favorite. There have been spans of years when I listened to these concerti only rarely, and if I limited my time to a single one of them, this has regularly been the one. It's always struck me as a more forward-looking composition than any of the others, more like the music of Handel than usual for Bach, and with clear premonitions of a new era that would dawn within about 25 years with the rise of early classicism. It is also unique in the set for having no real second movement, just a simple half-cadential chord progression in E minor to link the two actual movements, a peculiarity about which I'll have more to say later. The work is scored for violins, violas, and cellos all in three-way divisi, plus a bass line and continuo, and the soli group is not formally differentiated from the tutti. Only the first movement follows the standard ritornello plan, and even here the ritornelli are often just short phrases interspersed into a continuously modulating whole. Moreover, that movement is clearly constructed in three generously proportioned paragraphs, which I've identified as parts 1, 2, and 3. Part 3 is unusual in the introduction of a new countermelody, and that countermelody is almost identical to the opening gestures of the same composer's E major violin concerto. The texture is often describable, to use a term I more or less coined in my treatment of concerto number 2, as a kind of polyphonic homophony. The harmony often moves around greater or lesser portions of the circle of fifths, while the diatonic collection of the moment is kept intact. And the little lower neighbor motive that begins the piece, the first three notes of the violin parts, is ubiquitous throughout the movement, albeit couched in different ways in shifting harmonic and contrapuntal contexts. And none of what I've just said begins to capture the joy that just bubbles forth from this music. When it comes time for a second movement, we get only the faintest hint of one. All Bach wrote there was a simple Phrygian half-cadential progression, just two chords in E minor, a key choice which is precisely analogous to that for the first two concerti, but without supplying the movement. I've seen this addressed in a number of different ways. One of the first recordings I became acquainted with, I believe it was Anthony Newman's, actually included an E minor movement borrowed from one of the composer's cantatas. In the recording made by Pablo Casals in the Marlborough Festival Orchestra, all we hear is that chord progression, completely unadorned and rather incongruous sounding. In most cases, we hear a short improvisation, either by the first violinist or by the harpsichordist, with the latter being the case in this recording by Karl Richter and the Munich Bach Orchestra. And then there's movement 3, completely unlike anything else to be found elsewhere in the set of 6. The movement is organized like a dance movement in 2 repeated strains with no differentiation between tutti and soli forces and behaving for all the world like a movement in rudimentary sonata form with both sections repeated. I have in fact supplied an analysis that reflects this peculiarity. It's not, of course, actually in sonata form, for which the requirements go well beyond what we encounter here, for the idea of dramatic unity that informs the set as a whole and music in general during Bach's era, wherein the texture, manners, and affects of the music do not change substantially within movements, is essentially inimical to the ideals of sonata form, with its all-important emphasis on thematic contrast and actual development. Nevertheless, it's quite clear that sonata form grew out of just such music as this, and it's fascinating to see how close the parallels are. If you've been following my series, you're going to see some very familiar language in my analysis of this movement. Beyond the fascination that that formal approach holds for me, I can't think of very much music that I find more engaging than this. The music unfolds as an irresistible outpouring of fast 16th notes in a 12/8 time context, sometimes just rising and falling, arcing and pirouetting, and from time to time adopting a fiddling posture. If you'll keep your eye on the contrary motion one often sees between upper and lower voices, I believe you'll be as entertained as my cats are when I make that bird on a string fly and jump and hop all around the room. There's more fun per measure in this music than in almost any other music I know, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I do.
Thank you. Thank you.